Welcome, everyone, and welcome back to the Reduce and Reuse Working Group. Can you go to the next slide, please? My name is Janice Paré. I'm going to be the host of the meeting today. We have a lot of speakers. Starting off with our agenda, we're going to do a little welcome and introduction. We're going to give you a little bit of a refresher on what the Reduce and Reuse Action Plan is because it's been a while since we all met. And then we wanted to go through some updates of what we've been doing over the last, 16, 18 months since the group was last together. We're going to talk about the DECON working group, what we've been doing with reusable takeout containers, Green Sword, which is working with schools, an update on textile recovery, and then grant reminders, some of the grants that are coming up this spring. We're going to talk about our next area of focus, and then we are going to have an open discussion and announcements. But I just want you to know there will be points along the way in which we will open it up to questions after, you know, big chunks have been spoken about, so that you guys can ask your questions while the questions are top of mind. So can you go to the next slide, please? Just as a reminder, this meeting is being recorded. We always record these meetings and we put them on the MassDEP R&R Working Group webpage. So we will send a link to that page and the recording and the notes after this meeting. Please remember to mute yourself if you are on the call and you accidentally came on with your, your audio on. Please turn it off. We will likely go through and mute you if you accidentally unmute yourself during the meeting. If you have a question, please use the chat function. You'll see the chat on the bottom of the screen. You can write your questions there. Gail will be looking at the chat box and answering questions that she can, but also during the discussion, she'll be reading them out. If you have a question that is easier to ask, you know, verbally, please feel free to raise your hand. You can certainly, we will call on you during those points. If you have a clarifying question, you can put it in the chat and we'll try to get to those quickly. Again, just please mute yourself and please name yourself and put in the organization you represent so everyone knows who we all have here today and networking can ensue. Next slide, please. So just this is our panel today. I'm going to let everybody take a minute to introduce themselves. So I'll start. I'm Janice Paré. I manage our education outreach in the Municipal Waste Reduction Branch. I work on Recycle Smart, and these are new, more robust reuse initiatives that we're doing now. I'm working closely with Kathy, so I'll let Kathy go.
Sure. Hi, everybody. I'm Kathy Mirza. I'm the branch chief for Municipal Waste Reductions at MassDEP. Five of us on the call today are part of my team. And we work on technical assistance and grants and education associated with all things waste reduction. So we're really happy you're here with us today. I will pass it over to Michaela, who's also on my team.
Hi, everyone. I'm Michaela Guglielmi. Yes, I'm with the Municipal Waste Reduction Group. I support the SMRP grant program, and I do some work with textiles, which I'm going to be talking about today. So happy to be here. Thanks.
Gail, you can go next.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gail Swarter-Garen, regional planner for MassDEP. I focus on the Recycling Dividends Program grants, as well as Household Hazardous Waste regional grants. And our focus today for me would be our School Waste Reduction and Diversion Working Group, which is a statewide working group.
And Leah?
Hi, everyone. My name is Leah Kelleher. I work closely with Janice on Recycle Smart and more of the outreach side of our recycling and reuse and repair education. I also work closely with both Janice and Kathy on all sorts of reuse initiatives, including our deconstruction working group. Excited to be here, new to the team, and excited to meet you all.
And Heather?
Hi, I'm Heather Billings. I work for the Center for Ecotechnology, and we are contracted with MassDEP to provide the Recycling Works in Massachusetts program. So that's technical assistance for businesses, institutions, and schools to reduce, donate, and divert materials in compliance with the waste disposal bans and other initiatives. And we are working on the best management practices for reusable containers for food establishments.
Thank you. So that's our team today. I noticed in the chat that Louise put her name and mothers out front in the chat. And thank you, Louise. I actually meant to say people should please introduce themselves in the chat. That way you guys can connect. I think that's a really great practice. So if you guys all want to, you know, introduce yourselves via the chat, that'd be fantastic. Next slide, please. So just as a refresher about the Reduce and Reuse Action Plan, we're going to put a link to the action plan in the chat for those of you who are interested in taking a closer look. MassDEP's vision and strategies to reduce upstream waste generation via reuse and repair are on that page. The task was to identify barriers, opportunities to increase reuse, and ways to measure our progress. So if you've been on these meetings before, you know that a lot went into the creation of that action plan, and now we are in the implementation phase. So next slide, please. So the priority materials in the action plan, these are the materials that we decided we wanted to target, you know, through the many meetings that we had with stakeholders. Like I think it was through 2020 and 2021, single-use packaging, textiles and clothing, household durable goods, building materials, electronics, business and institutional furniture, fixtures, and equipment. So today we're actually going to, as I mentioned before, go through the progress that we've made in some of these areas. So we'll see this slide cropping up a few more times during the meeting so you know which priority material that we're talking about. Next slide, please. The action plan also outlined strategies that we have in our toolbox, including education, resources, and networking, which is really what this working group is about. And some of the strategies defined can be implemented by MassDEP, and others require partnership and collaboration with stakeholders in various groups and agencies. So that's why we have these working groups to bring expertise in from others and other agencies, other stakeholders to fill in the gaps and make bridges between what we can provide and what more is needed. So next slide, we're going to just jump right into our DEP updates. So we're going to start off with Kathy Mirza talking about doing an update on the Mass Deconstruction Workgroup. So Kathy, I give you the floor.
Sure. Next slide, please. So good afternoon, everyone. I'm so glad that we're back together again, this larger Reduce and Reuse work group, because it has been over a year since we last met and connected. But for the next few minutes, I'll be focusing on the deconstruction work group. And you can see on this slide that the arrow is pointing toward building materials. And so that is what this particular working group is focusing on. So since the fall of 2022, the deconstruction work group has met 5 times. We try to meet on approximately a quarterly basis. And through those meetings, which I hope many of you have joined us for, we've explored a variety of topics to expand our knowledge of this sector and to connect with different stakeholders who want to work together with us to develop some reuse opportunities that are both practical and effective. So I'm going to refresh everyone on what we've covered in the deconstruction work group in the past year. So next slide, please. So just so we're all speaking the same language, when I refer to deconstruction, I'm talking about the process of disassembling or dismantling a structure and its components to maximize the recovery of valuable and reusable materials. So think of it as construction in reverse, which in many cases is a viable alternative to traditional demolition. Now, the photo you see here in the slide comes from a job site in the Seaport District of Boston. It was taken last year, and it shows what it looks like to set up a site for dismantling and this very important part, the separation of building materials into different categories so that they can be marketed for reuse or recycling. Next slide, please. This is another photo from that same site. What was pretty awesome, I actually took this photo. I got to be there for a bit of time while they were doing this. That large piece of equipment in the background has a grapple on it, and the person operating it was able to pull lumber from that building and keep it in such good condition. And then you'd see the piles in the foreground. Some of that lumber is 100 years old and still in excellent condition. Next slide, please. So this gives you a snapshot of the goals we have for the deconstruction work group. And as I mentioned, we really are aiming to get a better understanding of how much construction and demolition material is being wasted in Massachusetts and to identify opportunities for reuse to the greatest extent. We want to grow the reuse industry here for building materials, and we want to minimize the climate impacts of this material stream through better management of our resources, because these resources are already in circulation. So let's keep using them. Next slide, please. So in our first five meetings, these have been really robust and engaging. We've had high participation in all these meetings. This slide gives you a snapshot of the various sectors that are represented in these meetings. We've had over 100, but between 100 and 150 individuals attending each time, and it seems to keep growing. There's a tremendous amount of interest in this space and a lot of different stakeholders as well. So we invite folks to join us. If you haven't been with us before for these deconstruction work group meetings, by all means, feel free to dial in to us. And we've got recordings and presentations from the previous meetings on our website. So next slide, please. So what I'm going to do over the next couple of slides is just recap some of the high notes from the first five meetings, just to give you a little taste of the types of things that we've touched upon and what we take away. So in our first meeting, which was in 2022, we wanted to just define deconstruction. What are we talking about and why it matters? Some of the high notes that we learned there was that 30% of all the discarded materials in Massachusetts come from construction and demolition activities. Powerful data point there. We also learned the term embodied carbon, and that term has been used repeatedly in every meeting since. It's a very important idea within this work. And what embodied carbon really speaks to is the built environment, it represents the emissions that are generated from the extraction of materials, the manufacturing, the transportation, installation, maintenance and disposal of all the materials that go into the making of a building. And that contributes enormously to greenhouse gas emissions. At the second meeting, we wanted to get inspired about what was possible in this space and learn from some practitioners doing this in other parts of the country. So we learned that the demolition of one American home is equivalent to a lifetime's worth of trash for one person. It's an incredible amount of trash. We also learned that there are at least 25 different categories of materials that can be captured for reuse from buildings, such as doors, windows, hardware, lumber, roofing, cabinets, appliances, even landscaping. At the third meeting we had, we looked at market outlets for building materials. There are several reuse outlets in Massachusetts and more in the Northeast, and they had reported to us that they have an endless supply of materials. What's really important in this space is that they need quality materials, and that requires quality deconstruction, a space to store these materials, and demand for reuse and recycling. Next slide, please. So these are a couple of photos from one of the reuse organizations that came to that third meeting. They're called Doors Unhinged, just to give you a sample of what we learned. So the photo on the left are doors that they captured from a building that was being deconstructed. Up top, you can see that they're doing some work on these doors to retool them. And on the right, you can see where they were placed in a new project and how beautiful they are. Next slide, please. So quickly going through the next few meetings that we had, in the fourth meeting, we looked at the connection between historic preservation and building reuse. Because when you think about it, preservationists are already practicing reuse, and they have been for a really long time. Existing buildings maintain the culture and character of our communities, and we heard over and over again that the greenest building is the one that is already in use. There are also tax incentives that support preservation in that space. At our fifth meeting, we shared case studies of reuse and deconstruction that's happening here in Massachusetts already. We learned about a school built in Springfield in 1925 that was redeveloped into affordable housing, and a reuse project at Simmons University in one of their science buildings where they worked with a variety of reuse organizations, coupled with our team at Recycling Works, Heather's team, and they helped to remove 12 tons of material from that building for reuse in apartments and offices. So right now we're in the process of planning meeting number 6. We're at this transitional point in our work here because we're hearing from participants that we want to take actions toward what is needed on the local level to really enable more building deconstruction and reuse more commonly in Massachusetts. Next slide, please. So again, just wanted to show you a couple of photos. This came from our session about historic preservation. The top two photos represent a building in Hanover that was built in the 1830s, where they actually delayed the deconstruction of this building, excuse me, the demolition. The Historic Commission wanted to put a pause on it so that they could work with property owners and the North Bennett Street School that does carpentry to dismantle it and reassemble that building in another location. So that's what they did with the top building. At the bottom one is an example. This is a convent in Holyoke on the bottom left, but that was an example of adaptive reuse where it was updated and converted into housing units using tax credits. Next slide, please. This is another neat example. This was that school in Springfield that I referred to just a couple of moments ago. The top two slides show what disarray it was in and left behind when the school was vacated, no longer needed. Again, with the team from Recycling Works and other reuse organizations, they captured a lot of the valuable material from that building. And then a developer came in and converted that into affordable housing. So that now has been upgraded to 42 housing units. And you can see how beautiful it is in the bottom three photos. So next slide, please. So our next steps are really to develop a workshop. So we have a planning team that works together with experts in different parts of this deconstruction workspace. So we're working together on developing a workshop and putting policy together with examples from other jurisdictions. We intend to get feedback from the different sectors that are involved in this space. And together we want to create tools and resources that will enable more reuse and deconstruction in Massachusetts. So here's my contact information. Feel free to reach out to me if you would like to be part of this work group, and I'll make sure you are on our broadcast list. Thank you. And next up is Heather Billings.
Thank you, Kathy. I guess next slide, please. We are kind of that table of contents of the kind of key focus areas of this reduce and reuse working group. A component of that is the development of the best management practices for reusables in food service. And I am so pleased to be working on this project with Recycling Works as in close partnership with the Department of Environmental Protection and Department of Public Health. Next slide, please. So the best management practices are a consensus-based web resource to help both local health officials and food establishments implement food safe reusable programs that are consistent with the food code. And these best practices are also what we at Recycling Works base our technical assistance recommendations on. We have previously developed them in this same way for food donation, source separation, and hauler contracting. Next slide, please. Recycling Works conducted outreach to different stakeholder groups through our monthly newsletters, adding blurbs in existing association newsletters or meetings, direct emails to gather input from regulators, including health inspectors, local health inspectors, restaurants, universities, container service providers, community groups, and more. The list is about 150 people who have expressed interest or been involved in the process along the way. And we began gathering information in the fall about kind of what we knew, a very, very basic outline, convened two virtual stakeholder meetings to hear any and all input on the use of reusables. We then conducted 12 more in-depth interviews, incorporated what we learned into an outline form, and identified areas that could use more clarification, and sent that over to DEP and DPH for review. And this is where we're at currently. We will incorporate the feedback and build out a full document and then share that for comment. Next slide, please. Through these meetings, with the facilitated discussion in smaller breakout rooms with note takers, three distinct scenarios emerged. The use of establishment-provided containers for takeout, consumer-provided beverage containers for takeout, consumer-provided containers for bulk retail. And we also heard ideas and concerns about scaling up the use, but put that part aside just for now to focus on the food safety and the details of the use of reusables. Next slide, please. So for establishment provided containers, the areas to develop or follow procedures on are the container selection. So just like regular durables for dine-in, there's a section in the food code, like 4.1, 4.2 of the merged food code that discusses what makes a good food service item in great detail. So their inspection process also kind of follows throughout all of these different components. So I'm just going to go right to filling the containers first, which is the same. Excuse me, I'm sorry, I lost my place for just a minute. So I'm gonna go back to the container selection. We have several types that are shown here. There's a glass container with a removable lid on the left. We've got metal containers in the center, polypropylene on the right, the number 5. Some have the separate top and some have a clamshell design. So when the inspection is happening, we're looking for to make sure that the containers are not cracked, no parts are missing, there's no little bits of food that happen to get caught in crevices. So that type of ease of use is also part of the considerations for the container selection, like what will be put inside it. Then we have the filling of the containers. And that really is the same motion that a food establishment would use for filling a single use to go container. Collection of used containers. We've heard that should be in a designated area like a bus bucket or a tub, and that should be regularly emptied and cleaned out. The washing and sanitizing of containers. Well, that would be in a dishwasher or if the establishment uses a 3-bay sink. They would follow the normal procedure that they would use for washing their durables. The containers would be air dried completely before stacking and storing, which is also according to code. And like I mentioned, inspection occurs at every phase. So during the washing, sanitizing, drying, storage, filling, there's always an opportunity to remove that container from service. Just like, you know, if you've ever gone to a restaurant and had a plate or a fork that didn't come out of the wash cycle just quite right, there's that opportunity to pull it from circulation. Next slide, please. Consumer-provided beverage containers. There are many convenience stores and coffee shops that are already allowing or encouraging the bring your own cup at this point now. The fill procedures are such that the cup would not touch the fill type, like, you know, pulling out coffee, putting it under a beverage container. If the cup crosses the counter, there are a few more considerations. Is the cup suitable for use? Like, you can't just give them a paper cup and say, I'd like to have my coffee in my own paper cup. Does the customer hold on to the lid? Does this produce a question of pricing or recipe concerns, because the cup may be different size from what the typical, or what the establishment provided to-go container cup is? So in that situation, it came up that a durable back of house cup could be used and then poured into the customer's reusable cup. Some coffee shops have back of the house cups that have fill lines for their different ingredients and recipes. Next slide, please. So another, it also came up about consumer provided containers in a retail scenario. So what type of container would be allowed? Could it be a deli tub, a yogurt tub, glass only? Should it be dishwasher safe? And if a consumer brings their own container to be filled, we need to determine the tear weight. So that container would have to be weighed and the weight noted. So that's an opportunity for the establishment to give it an inspection to see if it's an appropriate use of a container or appropriate container for use. And then the store would need to have likely some customer filling practices. Like, do you use a scoop? Is the scoop switched out after people touch it? Are the fill containers such that the customer container doesn't touch them? Like, you lift up a handle and the product comes out. And then the question is, kind of for all of these, are there any additional local restrictions or variances that would be needed? And are there any limitations of what the cup or container could be used for? Next slide, please. So if anyone here would like to be more involved in the process, we would love to have you. Please contact us and we will add you to that list of interested stakeholders. You can still schedule a one-on-one conversation with us, and we will be receiving written feedback on our draft. So happy to take any questions if that's appropriate now or later. There it is.
Yeah, so now we'd like to open questions for, because this is kind of like a topic change we're gonna go into in the next section. So if anybody has any questions for Kathy or Heather, please either put them in the chat or you can raise your hand.
And so far, there's only one question in the chat, which Kathy has answered. But was what policies to be drafted for towns and munis to force participation in deconstruction? And Kathy has provided a link, as well as Andrew Thompson provided something about Boulder, Colorado.
Great. Is there anybody else? We can move on. All right. I'll mute myself. Let's move on, Leah, if you wouldn't mind.
Can you see that again?
I see questions, yeah.
Okay.
We go to the next slide. There we go. So the next speaker will be Gail. So please take it away.
Thank you, Janice. Hi, everyone. So Heather just talked about practices for reusables in the food service industry. Next, we're going to take a look at the school program we have in place to help reduce single-use plastics in K-12 schools. Next slide, please. First, I wanted to give you an overview of our statewide school waste reduction and diversion working group that we call Green Sword. This working group was created so that municipalities, school staff, and volunteers could have a forum to discuss waste reduction issues that they had in their K-12 schools, share their success stories, and lessons learned and learn from their peers. The Green Sword has four virtual meetings a year, and currently we have four working subgroups that meet every 1 to 2 months. I just want to give you a little bit of information about all of the subgroups, even though only one really applies right now to reduce and reuse. We have an institutionalizing pool waste reduction and diversion policies working group. In this group, we've created a template for school waste reduction and diversion policy that any school district can adopt, as well as have a recycling champion job description that schools can incorporate as a stipended position to assist with these school waste reduction programs. In addition, we've developed bullet points that can be added to custodial, kitchen, or cafeteria staff and volunteers whose job descriptions obtain because of the implementation of school waste reduction and diversion programs. Next is our school organics collection for on-site and off-site composting working group. Work involving school waste reduction and diversion through share tables and donation is also included in this subgroup. This group has created a flyer for reducing food waste in schools and has compiled resources, including waistband information, school compost guides, and a cost analysis for implementing school composting. Thirdly, we have a school sustainability program kickoff and events group. This group has been creating flyers containing ideas of activities to implement in schools to promote occasions like Earth Day and an end of the year locker and clean out. So finally, we're going to talk about our transitioning from single-use disposables to reusable food serviceware. Next slide, please. So in this working group, we're focusing on a few items in schools. We're looking at replacing polystyrene and compostable trays containing PFAS with reusable trays, replacing disposable plastic dishware and cutlery with durable alternatives, installing or refurbishing dishwashers, and switching to bulk dispensers for milk and condiments instead of using disposable cartons and packets, and finally installing water bottle filling stations to eliminate the need to purchase single-use water bottles. We're working with organizations like MassDEP's Green Team and Recycling Works in MA to help schools make the switch to reusables, as well as some nonprofits like the Center for Environmental Health that has a ditching disposables toolkit, Rethink Disposable, who provides support and has case studies on switching to reusables in schools, and Plastic Free Restaurant, who provides funding for making that switch to reusables. The goal of Green Sword is to share resources and create best practices for things like this transition to reusables in schools to make the transition easier for all K-12 schools in Massachusetts. Next slide, please. So we would welcome any new members to Green Sword. Please just keep in mind that you have to be a teacher, municipal or school staff, or a volunteer at a K-12 school to participate in this working group. To become a member, you can contact me at the email on the slide, and I can give you access to our Google group and our Google site. I'll also send you an invitation to register for our next quarterly meeting, which is on May 8th at 10 a.m., and it's virtual. And if you're interested in joining one of our four working groups, let me know, and I can put you in touch with that group leader. And I did see that Amber Schmidt from Rethink Disposable is on this call today, and she is the leader of our reusables subgroup. And that's all I have. If there are any questions, I'm happy to answer any.
We did get a question from Peg Hall. She wanted to know, are there carrots or sticks from DEP to schools to reestablish composting programs abandoned during COVID? 5 tons a month now going in the trash.
Shall I take that, Janice?
Sure.
I think it's a great question, and I do hear that a lot of schools have struggled with similar things, and Gail would know best as leading the Green Sword group because they meet regularly to talk about such challenges. I can say that, you know, our Green Team, the state's Green Team, does have some equipment resources to help with collecting organics, you know, so carts are available for free. for certain uses through our green team, for green team teachers that sign up for that. There's technical assistance available through our Recycling Works program, where Heather Billings works. So there can be sometimes in-person help, but certainly phone assistance as needed for any technical questions. Some of your municipalities may have some grant funds that you've kept aside, perhaps, and I'll be talking about those grants in a little bit, the Recycling Dividends Program grants. Many communities earn substantial funds through that program, and investing those funds in compost collection at the schools is certainly an approved use and a use that's encouraged to try to capture those organics out of the school waste stream. So there may be some funding through that tool, and then also, of course, joining Gail's Green Sword group and connecting with others who have done it or who are working on it right now. I don't know if anyone else here has any other thoughts to add to that. Okay.
No, I don't, but I know that Recycling Works has provided good technical assistance for those that wanna, you know, get it back up online. I know they can go out and do a site assessment and stuff like that. So I would take them up on that if you're interested. There's also a question about, I'm going to interpret this as, is there any movement from DEP to make it a requirement for new school construction to have dishwashers? You can take it, Kathy.
Well, you can probably see the smile on my face. It's not a DEP requirement. So, but I will say that a number of years ago, there is a program for high performing schools that some of our team at DEP helped to provide some input regarding waste reduction practices for school buildings that are being remodeled or updated. Ideally, it would be certainly a requirement for new schools to have the ability and the space to be able to capture materials for reuse and to be able to wash reusables. That's not under our purview to have that sort of requirement, but I can just share with you that we were able to provide some input a number of years ago. But that would be other agencies that really oversee that. Certainly the school for, it's a high performance school, like a CHIPS is the acronym for it. And then they're perhaps communicating with the Mass School Building Authority might be beneficial from the municipal folks.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you. There was another question about recycling that was similar to composting. I think the answer is the same. You know, there's Recycling Works, Green Team, RDP funds, different grant funding through the Sustainable Materials Recovery Program, which is the municipal branch's grant funding source. So I'm going to skip to, will you take any high school students to be involved in Green Sword? We have an environmental group that could benefit from this. So, Gail, that's eligibility requirements.
Yeah. At this point, we are not opening it up to high school students. Having students would create an entire different dynamic. I would love to have a separate group. But at this point, there's nothing in the works. But definitely, if that high school student has a mentor or a green team leader, get them involved in Green Sword. And, you know, at points we've had students kind of in the background while that teacher was participating. They can ask questions through the teacher. They can just, you know, observe and soak things in. But yeah, we prefer to have a direct communication with somebody who works at a school. Yeah, I mean, I would love to.
Decision makers.
But,
Decision makers.
Yeah. Exactly.
Are there any resources available to give to schools to encourage participation in reusable food trays, dishwasher installation, and installation of water bottle filling stations? So I can answer this, but Amber Schmidt also put in some information. Rethink Disposables is available to help provide funding and will also conduct cost savings and waste reduction audit to show school decision makers the cost and environmental benefits of switching to reusables, which is pretty amazing. But also we do have the micro grants, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. And they are definitely open two schools to apply for replacing single-use food serviceware with reusables, and that includes, you know, installation of dishwasher if that's possible. So there's another question, and then I think we should move on. It's how about dishwashing hubs for school districts where dishwashers are not possible? I mean, I think that's part of like a, and maybe that's like a larger discussion. I'm not sure that Gail can answer that, but Kathy, did you want to say something? You have a smile on your face. Like,
well, I'm just smiling because I appreciate this conversation and the enthusiasm in the room. I can't help myself, but honestly, I think that's a wonderful idea. I mean, certainly we have some grants available, and as Janice mentioned, we're going to go over a few of them in just a few minutes. In the different types of grants we have for different folks in the sector to think about whether something there applies to you. But be creative. We want to bring as many resources into our area that will allow for reuse and wash, you know, the ability to wash these items is an important component of them. So I guess I would just say, you know, watch for grants. If you're the type of business that can provide that type of service, or if you know of those that do, please point them our way. Thanks.
Okay, so thank you, Kathy. Like, let's move on to the next portion of the webinar, textile updates. Michaela, please give us your update.
All right, thank you. Hi, everyone. So I'm Michaela. We can go to the next slide. And yes, out of this little chart we've been doing, I'm focusing on textiles and clothing today. So next slide. So just a little review about the textile waste span. In 2022, there was a waste characterization study done where they basically just like looked at like the percentage of everything in the trash, and 5.2% of it was textiles. So that was about 230,000 tons of textiles in the trash. So we want to keep textiles out of trash, focus on reusing them. And the solid waste master plan was established. Again, it has a lot of goals, but the textile specific goal was to reduce disposal of textiles to 127,000 tons, which would be a 50% reduction from the 2018 baseline. So in November of 2022, MASTEP expanded its waste ban by adding textiles and mattresses, banning them from disposal. So a waste ban is just anything that prohibits the disposal of items as trash. There's already waste bans for several different items like recyclables, yard waste, things like that. And now we have textiles and mattresses, which are our most recent addition. And just to quickly review the definition of textiles, it can be clothing, footwear, bedding, towels, curtains. It's just anything that is not contaminated with mold, bodily fluids, insects, oil, or hazardous substances. So if it is contaminated with those items, it is considered not a waistband item. It can be disposed of as trash if it's contaminated. So next slide. To, you know, try to get the word out about the waistband and just promote it and provide some resources, we have this webpage as on mass.gov for clothing and textile recovery. We do try to use the word recovery when referring to textiles instead of recycling, just because there's sometimes confusion with the general public and they think they should put textiles in their curbside recycling bin. So definitely don't want that. So yeah, this website, check it out if you haven't already. There's a lot of great information, fact sheets, infographics. We have a list of textile organizations operating in Massachusetts and their contact info. So lots of great stuff there. And on the next slide, we have another textile recovery resource, Beyond the Bin, which is part of our Recycle Smart MA initiative. And it's a directory for the general public to find drop-off locations for textiles and other materials that can't go in the household recycling bin. Again, if you haven't looked at this, it's a great way to find a donation bin or a spot, and you can filter it to your location. So it's a great resource. And the next slide. So switching gears a little for municipal textile data. Since the waistband, there's been an uptick in the number of municipalities reporting that they collect textiles, which is great to see. In 2023, we had 245 out of the 351 municipalities in Massachusetts report that they collect textiles. And municipal tonnage collected was also at an all-time high of 7,988 tons in 2023, and that's textiles collected from municipal programs. So next slide. So a few weeks ago, we had some staff from MassDEP meet with textile recovery organizations. We called it the Textile Summit. So we presented some of that information for them, as well as some grants to them. And we also asked them to fill out a survey for us, and 9 organizations responded. So I just wanted to highlight a few things from that survey. We asked them, how are they collecting the material? And the majority of these organizations said that they use drop boxes as their primary collection method. And most of them also have one-day collection events as their secondary collection method. And a few organizations offer residential curbside pickup services, and some work directly with businesses that generate textiles in-house. So next slide, another question we asked are, what outlets are being used for all the material and textiles they collect? So all of the textile organizations that filled out the survey said that there was an increase in tonnages collected since the 2022 ban. And the majority of them said that they utilize domestic markets for about 80% of those textiles and materials that they manage. Less than half indicated that they use international markets, and the ones that do are using them on a more limited basis, between like 20 and 60% of the material they manage. And then most of them said that less than 20% of the material collected ends up as trash. And that's typically stuff that they collect that's not even textiles, maybe considered bric-a-brac. So that was good to see. And then the last question we asked on the next slide is what they want the general public to know. What are some things that they wish we knew about the textile recycling world? And one person said that, or one company said, reuse should be prioritized over recycling. Another one said, old clothes and scraps of materials don't belong in the trash and they have value. More is recyclable and reusable than you think. Which I thought that was great to see, because I do get a lot of questions from the general public about what do I do with my damaged clothing. And I tell them that it's okay, like there's outlets for this material, you can put it in the bin. And lastly, the textile industry has a significant environmental impact. Every piece of clothing or textile donated diverts waste from landfills, conserves resources, reduces carbon emissions, and supports a circular economy. So that is it, and we'll take a break for questions.
Thanks, Michaela. It was a great rundown there quickly. Does anybody have any questions about the textile work we've been doing over the last year and a half? No. One thing I want to say, make clear, when you are searching beyond the bin, there's a button you can push to sort by location, and to find the bin closest to you, you really need to push that button. I see a hand, Wayne.
I continue to be the one asking too many questions, but bear with me for the moment. So I'm curious about when you talk about textiles and general fibers, and I kind of come from an industrial background, two questions. One is, can you provide in a link or somewhere an example of what is the reuse or the recycled product that is being made with the fibers and with the clothing? That, I think I've been asked that question a lot, and I don't have a really good direct answer, and I'd like to be able to provide it. So if that's something you have some education on, that'd be wonderful. And another question is, living on the coast, I've seen some recent activity about lines, like marine lines, fishing gear, which is also fiber in particular. And I'm wondering if there's an overlap with that, and if that material can get recycled. I'm investigating it myself as well, and I kind of wanted to reach out maybe with this larger group if there's some information and knowledge there. It's called Net Your Problem is one of the organizations. So thank you.
I always love a pun. So somebody's saying they are nylon and it's recyclable. Okay, so to answer your first question about like what is happening and where you can find that information, we do have the mass.gov website for textile recovery, and there's like a link to SMART, which is, I can't remember, Michaela, do you remember what that acronym is?
Secondary Material Association of Recovered Textiles.
Very good.
I'm looking to put that graphic in the chat right now. So,
okay, so they are like the trade industry that, you know, has all the information on the kinds of things that are made. But generally speaking, like what Michaela was saying, a lot of it is used for resale. Reuse is like the reselling of it. And then if it's recycled, it can be made into wiping rags, or it can be cut down into and used as insulation. Those are like the two main ones that I hear about a lot. But I think that organization has more information on that. And then, you know, Michaela, have you heard of them, of the textile organizations, of vendors that are taking stuff? Are they talking about recycling the nylon? I mean, I wonder, I mean, especially on the coast, because there are, sorry, I asked you a question and then I kept talking, but along the coast, I know they have like the boat wrap collections. So it seems like, you know, there could be specialized collections for that kind of material as well, but it would, you know, the boat wrap collection is organized by like the communities on the Cape and volunteer organizations. And like, I think one of the ocean groups. So it would be kind of need to be like a special collection, I'm thinking, to sort of set that up. But it's definitely obviously a big problem, and I would love to see more of that getting collected.
And Janice, it looks like some folks have added some helpful information into the chat as well to help answer this in case you haven't been able to see it.
Okay.
So that also helps. So we really appreciate folks on this call chiming in with resources like this to help fill in some of the gaps in information and to help us better understand some of the outlets. So thank you for adding that in. There are a couple of questions. I see one from Eve Carey in Framingham about a way to be sure that textiles are disposed of for recycling or actually recycled. And it kind of connects with another comment from Yuli Fuentes Medel from MIT, I think, that said, how can we support on textiles from MIT? For me, that kind of goes together, because one of the things that came up, well, first of all, I'd say for Eve, definitely speak to whatever vendor you're working with and ask them for detail, as much detail as possible, to vet it as to where those materials go, and work with them. And hopefully they will share with you to a level of comfort that you have. But what came up in a conversation that Michaela mentioned at that textile summit that maybe MIT could help with is the idea of a third-party certification for textile recovery organizations. It kind of bubbled up in the conversation, and might there be a way to improve confidence with what is happening with these materials when they're collected for reuse or recycling? And how can we get more transparency in that space about where materials are going and a better understanding of it? So someone brought up in that conversation the idea of perhaps third-party certification so that perhaps organizations could be vetted independently as to how they manage materials, but open to ideas that others may have here.
Yeah, that's, That would be awesome. There is another question. What was the process like to get the ban passed? Was there a lot of opposition? I don't know the answer to that. I assume that there was. I know that it took a long time. Yeah. Brooke's on the call.
Worked here.
Brooke's on the call. Brooke, do you want to be our historian?
Sure. You know, I mean, I think it helps that Massachusetts is a so-called waistband state. We've been banning items. The first waistband was in 1991 for yard waste. But there was opposition. I mean, surprisingly, even the first stakeholder group we had was probably 4 years ago. I'm still saying we, even though I'm retired. I'll work it out eventually. You know, even the initial conversation with the textile recovery folks that many of you are using, there was concern. I think generally that's just a reflection of, you know, the feeling of the private industry that when government's getting involved in their business, it's probably not going to be good for them, you know. But as we worked and continued to meet with them and have a dialogue over the 3 or 4 years leading up to the ban, and assured them that, you know, this was not going to be a ban without a plan, so-called, that there were markets, that we were engaged in education. I think 90% of them came around and went from like, no, or where this really makes us nervous to, you know what, this is a good thing. And it's actually going to help our business because it's going to mean more stuff. I mean, generally the textile folks have said the biggest competition is the landfill or the trash can, you know, and mm-hmm. there's plenty to go around. And the waistband, well, it doesn't mean an overnight everybody stops putting it in their trash. We could see from the data that Michaela shared, it certainly has moved the needle. So that helps.
Thanks, Brooke. There's another question. I don't want to take too much time on this, but just a question about poor condition. And then there was a question about enforcement. So a lot of the vendors will say that they want gently used stuff, but they will take all levels of poor quality to great quality. And they want your good quality stuff because if you get the good quality stuff, it sort of balances out the cost of dealing with maybe the poorer quality stuff that they, you know, sell at a discount. So in the wholesale market, and believe me, it's a really complicated wholesale market. So they want all levels because they have markets for all levels. So all levels put in the bins and don't feel bad about it. Unless it's, you know, contaminated, like Michaela said. So enforcement is a kind of a different topic. I don't really want to take us down that road. So if somebody, you want to email me later, I can tell you how we enforce it. Let's move on to the next, or we can talk about it at the end if we have time. Leah, you want to move on to the next?
Yes. All right.
All right. And it's Leah. Leah gets to be the presenter.
Perfect timing. So yes, hi everyone. This is Leah. We're going to switch gears now and talk about a few grant opportunities offered by MassDEP. So I'm going to start with our reduce, reuse, repair micro grants that Janice mentioned a couple slides back. And as its name suggests, the micro grants are for reduce, reuse, and repair projects. So recycling and compost projects are not eligible for these grants. There's a bunch of different entities that are eligible to apply. That includes businesses, nonprofits, regional authorities, municipalities, schools, and colleges. And it's worth noting that we've bumped up the cap for this award to $10,000 this year. So awarded applicants can receive up to $10,000 for projects. And those funds will be awarded as a reimbursement. And really what we're looking for are short-term projects that take less than a year to complete. And we're gonna have two rounds of grant applications this year with specific deadlines for each round. So the first round is open now and it closes soon on May 15th. So if you're thinking about applying, definitely apply sooner rather than later to meet that deadline. But we will have a second round, like I said, which will open October 1st, and that will close November 15th. And really, we love to see projects that are innovative, that are scalable, that have a high impact across Massachusetts or in a specific region, especially now that we've bumped it up to $10,000. And if you have questions or you're interested in applying, please, please, please review our grant guidelines, which are available on MassDEP's microgrant webpage. I'll post a link in the chat here in a couple minutes. We really encourage folks to review those guidelines before starting an application because they include all sorts of important information that'll help you along the way as you're filling it out, including a timeline for the grant process, what you'll need to apply, what to expect. And then we also have a whole list of example projects that would be eligible for the microgrants on there. And on that note, yes, I'm good to move on. On that note, we thought it would be fun to highlight some past micrograntees and sort of do a little spotlight section. But I thought it would also be fun to share that we've had 44 microgrants since 2019 that have been awarded. And that's equated to nearly $200,000. So like I said, the next couple slides, I'm going to show some of those past micrograntees, which we've sort of grouped into broad categories, some of which you'll recognize from that list of priority materials that you saw a couple slides back, along with some innovative projects. So we'll start here. Untold Brewing, which is a brewery based in Scituate, Mass, I hope I'm saying that right, used grant funds to test reusable pallet wraps in place of single-use plastic wrap. And they saw a ton of success. They saved about 1.5 pounds of plastic per use of the reusable wraps, which you can see on the right here of the slide. They look pretty cool and pretty durable. And wraps also saved $20 for every 13 uses. Another micrograntee, Sociedad Latina, is using grant dollars to train environmental justice youth leaders to create reusable shopping and produce bags from textiles. Pretty cool stuff. Microgrants have also funded reusable foodware projects. Stonehill College used grant dollars to set up a tracking system for their reusable takeout containers that are used on campus, along with some incentives that they put in place to encourage their students to return those containers when they were done using them, which I think a lot of us know is a really important step to make that whole system work. And then Recirclable used grant funds to help boost their reusable takeout container marketing. They partner with Massachusetts restaurants and they developed a set of key metrics for their partners, really to show them why this partnering with them matters, the impact that it has, and those metrics included waste reduction benefit as well. And on the right, you can see Stonehill College students with their takeout containers at the top, and then at the bottom, the Recirclable team with their containers. In the area of repair, the Bite Shop has used funds for electronics repair in the Boston area, and Computers for People use grant dollars to help launch a new location in Massachusetts to collect and refurbish computers. And there's a little shot of some hardware, some electronics from the Bite Shop up in the corner. And then last but not least, there have been several projects that target furniture and other large bulky items which is actually a category of materials that we're going to talk about at the end of this presentation. So it's fitting that we have it here too. HandUp used funds to support marketing for their used mattress resale. So they take mattresses, used mattresses, sanitize them, repackage them, and sell them. You can see a picture in the top right-hand corner of the slide of some of those mattresses. Fresh Start Furniture Bank used funds to open a new furniture collection dock, which you can see in that middle photo towards the bottom. And that really expanded how much furniture they could collect and how quickly they could collect it. And then Urban Missionaries expanded furniture storage at their little store thrift shop, which is a really cute name. And you can see a photo in the bottom left-hand corner of some volunteers there. When saying expanded, really what they did was established a shipping container in a parking lot so they could hold more furniture that was coming in and therefore increase their overall capacity. So you can visit our microgrants webpage for a closer look at some of these past grantees and more. And we're hoping that as you hear about these and others, that you'll get inspired for your own projects, and also that you can just see what's eligible. And there's a lot of possibilities out there. So we're excited to see what comes in terms of applications.
Can I just put in a little plug really quickly?
Yeah. Definitely.
So the deadline is May 15th, but the deadline for questions that will be publicly provided later this week is today. So if you have a question about the grant, please send it to me in an email and I will get back to you. And then I'm just going to compile all of the questions that we got and post it on the webpage later this week.
Perfect. Thanks, Janice. Now we're going to transition to Kathy.
Thank you, Leah. So going to switch gears just a little bit and spend a couple slides looking at grants available to cities and towns. So right now we have a grant that's live and it's called the Sustainable Materials Recovery Program Grant, or SMRP, as some refer to it as. And this is our largest annual grant for municipalities. And as I mentioned, it's live right now. We have a deadline of mid-June. And within this grant, there's a variety of options to request equipment or funding for all sorts of municipal waste reduction efforts. A couple that are highlighted here, a couple of the sections that are specific to waste reduction and reuse repair types of activities, I wanted to just highlight. This year, we're reinstating our equipment grant for reuse and swap sheds. That's the first one at the top there. And this is for cities and towns to set up a shed or a container where they can collect household goods that can be given away to other residents, of course, at no cost. So this provides funding for that type of shed. And these are really popular with residents. The second item that we've also brought back this year is our larger waste reduction grants. And for this grant, municipalities have the opportunity to write their own proposal for a larger project that will address waste reduction and reuse in their community. The value of these grants ranges between $20,000 and $100,000. I certainly encourage communities to reach out to me if you have ideas for this, so we can talk about it before you spend a lot of time applying, because it does take a fair amount of work in the planning and putting together your budget, timeline, deliverables, partners, and all that good stuff, because it's writing one's own narrative for that. We do find that because municipalities are the only entities that are eligible to apply for these grants, they can partner with nonprofit organizations or local businesses if they choose. For these waste reduction grants. It's just that the grant application must come in from a city or town. And last but not least, I want to mention our recycling dividends program, which is often referred to as RDP. It's a performance-based component of our grant that incentivizes best practices in waste reduction.
And in this part of the grant, municipalities can earn points for the different types of programs that they implement. So I'm going to highlight a few of these on the next slide, please. So within this recycling dividends program, we have a whole section on reuse where, again, where municipalities can earn points that have a dollar value associated with it. And that's a function of the number of households that are served by the program, the overall value of the grant. But you can see we have swap shops in here as an activity or community repair events, banning single-use plastics. We've added NIPS this year to that category. So some communities have already implemented a ban on NIPS. So that would count toward one of the items that's banned there to reduce single-use waste. We also have a section on deconstruction to really sort of plant a seed for municipalities to think about it and know that there is some grant funding that can support it. We've had the City of Boston come in and actually benefit from this deconstruction pilot program because they've had a pilot in the City of Boston. And so we encourage other communities to think about this, whether through their permit process or through deconstruction pilots to earn through this grant. We also look at tool libraries and libraries of things that are burgeoning all over the state. They're really wonderful opportunities for residents to be able to give something a try before they buy it. Items other than books that they can use and try once or twice and then bring it back and it's shared. And last but certainly not least, we have community zero waste events where organizations that are interested in reusing or retooling materials can come in and collect them on an event day from residents. So they walk away with a lot of materials that they want and the residents are able to donate them free of charge. So these are very well received and we support these through our grants. The next slide, I am really just going to speak very briefly on behalf of our sister branch at MassDEP that oversees grants for businesses and institutions. They have a grant called the Recycling and Reuse Business Development Grant. That's a pretty substantial grant, and it addresses certain targeted materials, including textiles, building materials, and the like. The deadline did just pass for this grant. It was March 29th, and they received a record number of applications this year. But I wanted to just point out that this is available, so if there are any businesses or processors on the call who manage materials, to kind of keep this on the radar for next time this cycle comes open, because these are larger grants to really help build capacity in our state for managing, as I mentioned, certain target materials for reuse and recycling. And that's all we have for our update on grants, and we'll open it up for questions.
Thanks, Kathy. I did get a question from Peg Hall. It says, will there be or can there be, this is a question for you, Gail. Will there be or can there be points awarded for RDP now or next year for supportive EPR, like resolutions, even understanding that we're waiting on the state legislature to finally pass some EPR bills this year, paint, next year, mattresses, Over 50 municipalities have passed such resolutions for paint in the last few months. Do you know about how we feel about that for RDP? You're on mute.
No, that isn't something that we've discussed, but we can certainly discuss it as we're looking at our calendar year 25 application or fiscal year 25 application.
Just so you guys know, Gail is the RDP master, so that's why I'm asking her. She runs that grant program. Which municipal entities can apply for the municipal grant for SMART grants? Is it DPW, DPF, schools?
There's one contact per municipality that can apply through our ReTrack platform. So every municipality should have a designated person that we have in our system for all of for the grant applications relative to the Sustainable Materials Recovery Program, which includes RDP. I hope that answers the question.
Me too. So then there's like a helpful comment from Melissa Wenzel. Minnesota just launched our $2 million sustainable building material management grant. One option applicants can request funding for is local government providing grants to their entities. It's a different way of divvying out the money. Let's see. Then Michelle Foster said, can you resend the link? But I didn't know which link. So if you want to let us know which link you were.
It was the link to the previous grants, but someone else, I think, sent it. So I found it. Thank you very much.
Okay. And then Rachel Smith, who is the grant manager for our Municipal Waste Reduction Branch, wrote, it's usually the DPW or Board of Health that applies for the Recycling Dividends Program and other SMRP grants. You can contact Rebecca Ferguson if you're unsure who your contact is for your town. So she also put Rebecca, her email in the chat. And then there was a question, I believe, about the micro grants. You'll need to send that to me in an email, please. I'm not seeing anything else. So are there any other questions? If not, we can, Peter?
Yeah, I live in Plymouth, and my question is, are you working with the established institutions like Habitat's Restore Program, the Salvation Army, St. Vincent de Paul, just to name three, that are already well-established, organizations that collect materials?
Well, we're working with them in the sense that they have received grants from us. Not all of those organizations, but certainly the Restore, and then New Life Furniture Bank. We are in communication with them through these meetings that we consider them stakeholders. So in that sense, yeah. But Kathy, did you have anything else to add?
Just that I appreciate the question, and we're going to touch on that in just a couple of slides because we want to encourage more engagement with those entities. So thank you, Peter, for bringing that up.
Okay, on that note, let's move on.
Shall I just take it away from here, Janice?
Yes, please.
All right, I will just take it away from here. So far what we've done in this meeting is really try to catch you up on all the things that have been happening in the last 15 months or so since we last met as a larger reduce and reuse work group. So you can see that there's been a lot happening. I mean, coupled with that, there's been a lot of transition on our team up at DEP in Boston. So hats off to everybody. Our team has worked really hard to keep things moving forward, and we want to continue to do so. Continue making progress in this space on our Reduce and Reuse Action Plan. So if you would go to the next slide, please. As you can see, we're kind of moving the arrows around on this slide that you've seen a number of times on the different materials that we're focusing on. And so going forward, we've decided together, we really think we want to really get our hands around this household durable goods and business and institutional furniture, fixtures, and equipment material streams that were designated in the Reduce and Reuse Action Plan. So we've consolidated these together for ease on our side, really just calling them the large bulky items. But we know that these are items that are coming out of both the residential stream as well as businesses and institutions. So next slide, please. So, as I mentioned, we're turning our attention a little bit and adding this into this kind of menu of material streams that we're working on, as you can see here. So when I was looking up MassDEP's definition for bulky waste, the terminology used in our regulations, it's defined as like waste items of unusually large size, including but not limited to large appliances, furniture, and then I'm adding and much more than that. And you'll also hear the term amongst our team used that it's not really waste until it's wasted. In fact, our most recent Recycle Smart newsletter that went out was titled, "It's Not Waste Until It's Wasted." And so for our folks here on the Reduce and Reuse work group, we really want to think about how we can reuse first. and reduced to the greatest extent. So when we talked about going after this bulky item stream, we decided we really don't want to be calling it bulky waste because it's not waste until it's wasted. We're going to call it bulky items. You know, so this is the big stuff. And we know that there are some entities out there, as mentioned by Peter a few minutes ago, that are already capturing some of these materials. We want to really get a better understanding, get our hands around this ecosystem much better so that we can understand the entities that will take it and help our residents understand and our businesses and organizations understand where they can take these materials for higher value use. So you can think of items such that a home improvement store or a furniture bank might want. You can think of beds and dining room tables and chairs and desks and doors and windows, appliances, and those sorts of things. Next slide, please. And as mentioned, you know, we do acknowledge that there are communities that accept large appliances right now for recycling, and that's good. But with items that are still usable, we really want to encourage reuse first. And some of these organizations will take that back for reuse. So there are a few primary reasons we want to get at this material stream. As some of you may know, we have a disposal capacity issue here in Massachusetts. We have some pretty severe constraints on our capacity. And we know that bulky items are often mixed with construction and demolition materials, and they're disposed of as trash, okay? And this, there was an analysis that was done by a consultant in 2022 that estimated that upwards of 382,000 tons of bulky items are thrown out for disposal each year in Massachusetts. They also shared that furniture and wood make up the largest percentage of this stream, with more than 50%. Now, furniture is a pretty broad category, the way they defined it in the study, but it includes wood, it includes cabinetry, countertops, doors, and all sorts of traditional furniture that you can think of. Coupled with this, we know that there are reuse organizations that serve to capture many of these items for reuse by both businesses and residents. Next slide, please. So some of the examples mentioned a few moments ago, but here are some here. We grabbed the logos just to put on the slide of some of the organizations that are already operating here in Massachusetts. I believe that every entity mentioned here has received a grant from MassDEP, but there are many other organizations out there as well. All of these organizations accept materials for reuse. We know the work is already happening, and we really want to enable more of this kind of work. So if you are part of the sector and you're on this call today, or you know of organizations that do this work, please contact us so that we can fold them into the discussion. Because as we move forward in the coming months, we really want to dial these organizations into the conversation so that we can work together again to enable more reuse and get the word out about these opportunities that are available and expand as much as possible through some of the grant support we can make available. We also want to include organizations like this in our Beyond the Bin directory that was shared earlier by Michaela, because that is a resource that is getting a tremendous amount of traction by the public when we see the data each month as to where residents are tapping into our web resources. The Beyond the Bin is utilized very, very highly. So we want as many of these organizations and resources noted within that. Let's see. So next slide, please. So I really just wanted to give you a little taste of the why that matters, what we're hoping to do. We want to think about how we're going to craft this going forward. So please stay tuned for more to come a little bit later this year. In the short term, we're working, as mentioned earlier, on developing the deliverables from some of the other areas that we spoke about today for our deconstruction work group, working on this, putting together a workshop for a little bit later this year, and also the best management practices for reusable foodware that Heather spoke to as well. And then we will take step forwards with this bulky item reuse. So that completes what we have to share today. And so I'm going to pass this over to Leah and Janice to open up the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. And thank you to Heather and Gail and Michaela and Leah for all of your updates. I really appreciated not having to do it. So thank you. Is there anybody who had any questions or wanted to tell us about your updates since the last meeting? Anybody working in this space who might have updates of their own? No. I saw that Norma, I don't know how to say your last name, Chanis. She said, we at Wachusett Earth Day would be happy to have folks out for a site visit to see what they're doing with furniture. Which sounds like an open invitation. Wachusett Earth Day is not an event. It is not, it's not a day. It's a place. Which is a little bit confusing sometimes. Norma, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to say, you know, thanks to the DEP, we started out with a $5,000 micro grant that paid for a couple of containers for us to use during the pandemic to save furniture for the furniture banks. From there, we went on to get a bigger grant last year that's letting us save you know, hundreds and hundreds of pieces of furniture that go out to our community for reuse or onto a furniture bank. And we're, you know, hoping to keep growing that program. So if anyone is interested in looking into doing this at their site, you know, we've kind of had three different variations of it. And we would love to share what we've learned and try to help somebody else do something similar.
Awesome. Well, maybe we should have you on as a speaker in a, you know, upcoming webinar for this group so that you can, you know, share what you've learned with this group. And I think that would be really awesome.
Yeah, no, would love to do it. It's been, you know, really well received by our public. We've already saved more than 500 pieces just this year alone.
Wow.
With our new structure. So
excellent.
It's been awesome. Thank you, DEP.
You're welcome. So I see that Donna has her hand up, and then I want to go to Lorinda. She has an update. Go ahead, Donna.
Thanks, Chanis. I just wanted to kind of piggyback on Norma's invitation because the Great Exchange is in the same vicinity as Wachusett Earth Day. And if anyone would like to come out and visit us and see how we are repurposing the business and institutional furniture and fixtures, we would welcome the visit. We've had an amazing increase in the amount of furniture that's passing through our doors, primarily because of the different work structures that are happening right now. And so if anyone's looking for furniture, come and shop, but would be, you know, welcome the opportunity to show the beautiful pieces that otherwise would be going into the trash if we weren't working together on these types of initiatives.
Thanks, Donna. And you know, I've seen Donna and the Great Exchange's work firsthand. It is an exceptionally well-organized place, like all the little trinkets that they got. And they came two or three times, Donna, to MassDP when we were moving location and took a whole bunch of stuff for reuse from our 30 years of existence, or even maybe closer to 40 at One Winter Street. So a great place to shop if you're looking for stuff. Did you have anything else to add, Donna?
Nope. Thanks for the opportunity and thanks for your great support.
No problem. Okay, so sorry, Lorinda, go ahead.
Thank you. I don't actually have an update. I had a question, but I think maybe I should just go talk to Norma, try to talk to Norma offline. I have a local college. I'm from Beverly, Mass., and we have a college, and at the end of the year, every year, even though we try to do volunteers to recycle all the textiles that the kids are just going to throw out and not take back home, we're trying to also stand up a huge reuse, resale of like the mirrors that they bought, or, you know, small, probably smaller pieces of furniture, because as you might imagine, the beds and the desks belong to the college. But would that possibly be like fall into the same category as this furniture furniture reuse that is being discussed right now?
I think it depends on the thing, but much of the smaller stuff, like the textiles and just the home furnishings, I don't think we would cover under bulky waste, but there's certainly a lot of organizations out there that are working to take that stuff, and colleges that have sustainability coordinators that are working on developing programs to collect it for reuse. So BU stands out because I've heard the woman there talk many times, and they have an exceptional program now for end of the year collection of stuff. And there's also a program, a group called Grad Bag, which I'm sure would love to work with you. They received a micro grant this year, and they take college wares from, you know, students that no longer need them, and they clean them up and make them look just like new, and then they redistribute them to lower income first generation students. I'm not sure if you actually need to be a first generation, but I think that's kind of like what they're looking for. But students that wouldn't be able to maybe afford that nice stuff on their own, but you know, it's all in like perfect working condition. So Brooke, I see, put the link to Grad Bag in the chat. Great organization. Brooke, you have your hand up.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Thanks, Janice. I just wanted to point out that Norma Chanis from Wachusett Earth Day, that got a grant from DEP, and I think it was one of the first through the recycling and reuse business development grant. So it was like an $80,000, $90,000 grant, as I recall. This was, you know, year before last. So, you know, there's some dollars out there. So way to go, Norma. I'm planning to go out there and see her operation.
Yeah. I mean, I know they got a micro grant too at the very beginning of that. So they're like on the cutting edge of this stuff. Is there anybody else? Kathy, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say, like in the college and university space, I know that Harvard has had a longstanding reuse program for materials and furniture, large bulky items from their students. UMass is expanding their program so that they can have not just events, UMass Amherst, but they want to have an ongoing reuse space. Northeastern definitely has events for their students. So again, more of this, the more the better in that university space, because there's so much waste at the end of the year, as we know, coupled with so much need for those that come in and could save a lot of money. And obviously it's mostly greatly beneficial for the environment to reuse rather than buy new. I'm wondering whether Amber Schmidt is still on the call. I see something in the chat about Truro's community kitchen that started a reusable container system for meals on wheels, which sounds really cool. And you're getting a bunch of comments here. I wondered if you wouldn't mind sharing just a little bit.
Oh, sure. That. Yes. And I'm sorry I'm not on camera. I'm actually at the church where they do the meals. So this is actually funded in part through the Mass DEP micro grant. So very exciting. It is a food delivery service to residents in Truro, Massachusetts on the Cape, to elderly, disabled, low income residents. It's completely anonymous. So anyone who needs food, who has food insecurity, can sign up. And they've served, I think, over 26,000 meals. It started during COVID. And then quickly realized after that there was a real need in the community for emergency food providers. And so has continued for the last 4 years since COVID to continue to provide these meals each week, every Tuesday. And for the past 4 years, they've used about 26,000 disposable items. A lot of those being those black plastic containers that unfortunately can't be recycled. And so we've now developed a system where each week we've purchased reusable bags, and reusable takeout containers. And the meals are made and put into those reusable takeout containers and into the reusable bag. They then go out into the community, and we ask that the residents eat their food, rinse the container out, and then leave their dirty containers in that reusable bag out on their steps. The following week, they get a new bag with all cleaned, sanitized containers and their new food, and the drivers will then pick up that old bag. And we've partnered with a school here that is allowing us to use their dishwasher to wash and sanitize all of the containers in between uses. So it's a one-to-one swap. So this is the first day. It launched last Tuesday. So that was the first day that everyone got their meals in reusable containers. And this is the first day that we're now expecting these containers to come back, and we're going to go to the school and we had to sanitize them before we used them before, which was, we had a lot. We purchased quite a bit of containers. So today is the first day that we're going to really see that kind of swap happening. But we've been able to completely reduce all of the single use disposable items that they were using, and have now replaced it with all reusable items. And we've gotten some really great feedback from residents. It seems to be a really good program. I've heard a lot of folks wanting to do this in similar situations in other towns. So I'm really excited to see this kind of move into that direction. So we can not only, help residents in need, but also, be reducing waste and helping the environment while we do it.
Amber, it's an awesome model. Thank you so much for sharing that. I can see a lot of smiles and hearts and thumbs up, and I can tell a lot of inspired folks on the call today. So thank you for sharing that. I'm so interested to also learn more about the school allowing the use of the facility for washing those items, because I must say in the reusable foodware working group that Heather shared about earlier, where washing space comes up as a question. And I don't know if you are at liberty to share anything about that, how that worked. Or even I've wondered about access to that, because every community has, most communities have schools. Yeah.
Yes. So, TCK, Truro Community Kitchen, is a nonprofit, and they've been really well received in the community. And so the church that they work out of, although it has a great kitchen space to, meal prep all the food, it's not big enough to install a dishwasher. We thought about that. And it's just really not the ideal space. So the co-founder, Eli Sobel of TCK, it's the Cape, so off season, a lot of folks know each other. And so reached out to several different colleagues and contacts, and the school was really willing and, wanting to be able to help facilitate this change. And so we do the cleaning after the school is closed. It's the Truro Central School. It's about 3-minute drive from the church. As long as we're able to get in there after they're all done with their cleaning, and then we bring them back to we bring the cleaned and sanitized containers back to the church where they're stored. So the storage facility is still the church. We just use the dishwasher for about an hour or so to sanitize everything.
Thank you for sharing. Great, thank you so much.
Thanks, Amber, that's really amazing. I love that. And then I just wanted to point out to Lorinda that Norma did respond. She said furniture banks are often working with local colleges for the cleanouts. So that's good news. There are links to all of the resources that we mentioned today. I think there was a whole slide dedicated to the stuff that, the reusable foodware resources. So these will all be on the slide deck on the webpage. Anything else? Go ahead, Wayne.
Just a point of clarification. I'm hoping that you can, this has been, first of all, absolutely wonderful. I've been on a lot of these kind of statewide calls, I found that not only was this well consolidated, but incredibly informative. And so thank you. In fact, I want to make it required watching for every one of my committee members, because these are all the subjects that we talk about on a regular basis. And I think that all the good work that you've been doing should get exploited in a good way, right? So if you can make this, I mean, I know normally in the administrative life, it takes a little while to get these recordings kind of uploaded, but if you could do that as soon as possible while it's, key and relevant in our own minds, that'd be great. Because I'd like to share this, and also all the links that have been provided, they don't end up in the recording. So if you can kind of capture those links that have been provided on this chat and be able to put them, on the site, that'd be wonderful too. So thank you very, very much.
No problem. Thank you. We always like to hear positive feedback. So thanks, Wayne. Brooke, more positive feedback?
Totally positive feedback. Amazing meeting. And I just wanted to throw out, this is now that I'm post EP and the gag is off, or so to speak, throw out just an idea for a future meeting about, I know it's so great to get ideas from external stakeholders, right? Like I can see the eye rolls happening. But just in conversations I've been having over the last couple of weeks with some folks working in this field, handling used materials, the challenge of keeping the doors open. It's a constant, you're either selling donated furniture or goods, and you're also supplementing that with grants, grant writing, trying to literally just keep the lights on. I mean, this could anybody on here, whether you're from Goodwill or Habitat Restore or Boston Building Resources or Donna Neely from Great Exchange, et cetera, can probably all relate. And I just, I think it's time that folks start in the public sector start thinking about the fact that we pay for trash collection, we pay for recycling collection, we pay for organics, but and that by that I mean we, the public sector, the taxpayer, but we don't pay for the programs that we all rely on, businesses, municipalities, and individuals that are handling the secondhand stuff. And so I guess I'm just sort of making the case. I tried making it when I worked at DP up the management chain and didn't get much traction, but planting the seed that, they're providing a valuable service, a critical service. If you took everything that gets donated and then had to put a price tag on the cost to throw that in the trash, and the municipality would be picking up the tab for that. We're talking, millions and millions of dollars every year. So anyway, it's kind of a radical thought, but in a conversation yesterday, I learned that the city of Boulder, Colorado, and this was thanks to Andrew Thompson from Boston Building Resources, that they actually do pay for, I think, provide the land or pay the rent for a building materials reuse facility in Boulder. They also have a deconstruction ordinance. So there are a few trendsetters out there. So throwing out an idea for how can we solve this funding problem and keep these organizations going that we so desperately need and depend on to advance the reuse economy.
It's true. Like if there's no outlet, where are you going to find the stuff? So Andrew, she just put in a plug for you, and now
she
have your hand up.
Yeah, I mean, I can piggyback on that. We, we've been doing this at BBR for about 30 years with the Reuse Center. There's a constant great flow of donations. We get stuff all the time. We've got commercial contractors and retailers and residential contractors and homeowners, like all manner of people who donate, shop. It's tremendous. We've got folks on this call who are encountering the same problem with reusable food containers. Like the logistics of this stuff, the cost of this stuff is, we all want it to exist, we all want it to be here, but this costs money, and you need space, and you need time, and you need to pay people to deal with it. And that is just an endless challenge. It's like, so any, support from towns, like encouraging your folks to donate things to reuse centers, making access on websites really easy, lists of resources, all that stuff is hugely valuable because we do it all by the skin of our teeth. I don't mean to speak for anybody else, but I would imagine you got the same problems when you're doing reusable food containers or other kinds of textile reuse. You know, it's a losing proposition trying to take in stuff people toss and make it useful again. It's tough. So it's great to be in groups like this to see so much support for it. And, you know, find the people in your community who are doing it and give them all the support you can, because they certainly need it. And, you know, thanks everyone for participating. It's lovely to see this community.
Thank you. Margie?
I just want to pile on to say, Brooke, like, it's great that you're able to just come in and say that, because it is, I mean, there's so many people on this who have been doing it way longer than we are. And I always say you have to be committed in two ways to do stuff like this. Yeah, and I love that idea because, so much of this right now, it's about finding the funding to continue what are the right things to do. And it's that in itself is a full-time job. So yeah, I appreciate the comment. And I appreciate, Andrew, your comments too. Thank you.
Kathy?
I'm grateful for these comments as well. I think we need to learn some more about what's happening in Colorado. We've got Leah here who has lived in Boulder for a while, right? Might have some familiarity with their programs. So we can certainly make efforts to learn more about what they've done to support reuse in Colorado. And I also recall on, I think it was a webinar a number of years back, that the city of Berkeley, California, I believe, contributes public funds, tax dollars toward urban ore. I see Andrew nodding. Urban ore is how do you describe them? They're one of the first like enormous reuse organizations that I ever heard of decades and decades ago. And so the amount of funding that goes to them, I think may be equivalent to what the tipping fee would be, or a percentage of the tipping fee had that material gone to trash instead of reuse, but just redirecting those dollars toward a higher value use rather than to disposal, if that makes sense to folks. So I appreciate these thoughts, and it's something for us to really think about further. Thank you. And I'll let Peter's got his hand up.
Yeah, I mean, so I'm here in Berkeley, and yes, Urban Ore does get, for every ton that they divert, it's equivalent to what the city of Berkeley would pay to have that go to the landfill in Alameda County that's out by Altamont Pass. But, you know, starting with Brooke, this question about, you know, among our many learnings at Fix-It Clinic is that we're not paying the true cost of the item when we purchase it at the moment. That really, you know, all the upstream and downstream costs of bringing that thing into our life is not constituted into that purchase price. And we think it's free to throw it away on the downstream end. So I'm trying to move as quickly as possible into more and more about how we move things so such that they stay in place, durable goods stay in place at their highest utility possible, for as long as possible. Because even, you know, our experience is like, once the item leaves the original owner's possession, once that flat screen TV is on the curb, the value of the item just plummets, right? You don't know if it has the remote, you don't know if it has the power cord, you don't know if it works or not. So we really have to think about how we develop policies that encourage people to keep things in place, in service, for absolutely as long as possible.
We agree. And we want to normalize it too. And we want everyone to start thinking along those lines. So I just want to put in a plug for Recycle Smart MA. If you haven't yet looked at it, our main focus there is recycling contamination, making sure that people are recycling the right things. But we're also, you know, talking about the upstream of reduce and reuse as having higher impact. You know, recycling is what you do at the end of the day, but what can we do with those things prior to that? And so if you are following us and we put up, you know, like a reuse post and we're like, what are you doing for Earth Day or Earth Month or whatever? And you put in your stuff, you know, like inspire others. Cause I think maybe we're all like in an echo chamber and it's all you guys that are our followers or whatever. But I think the more we can get out the message about how to reuse and repair and make it so that people understand that it can be convenient. We don't have to convenience ourselves to death in one way. We can convenience ourselves to life in a repair and reuse way if we're thinking about it in that way. So yes, thank you, Leah, for putting the chat in there. And Thanks everybody for your comments. Do we have anything else before we wrap up today?
My only thought is that repair, I'm glad you brought that up, Peter. Repair goes hand in hand with the bulky items that we're gonna try to get our hands around next. So stay tuned, we'll be looping you in. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm just looking at the comments coming in. I'm just making sure that we don't need to. Climate impact, embodied carbon of stuff is very helpful as that will push it. Yeah, I mean, I think Meryl, that the message of climate impact is like the salient one right now. Like people care maybe less about trash, or they don't really understand it. But if you, you know, like kind of put it in that greater umbrella of climate impact, it sort of resonates more. So yeah, we're trying to use that terminology a lot more frequently. We're trying to tie our message, at least for Recycle Smart, to tie our message to the climate impacts of our, you know, our purchasing habits and the choices that we make. All right. Well, thank you all so much for participating and for your wonderful comments and questions. And we apologize that it took us so long to get this meeting back on your radar, but we were very glad that we had a lot of positive and wonderful messages to share. So with that, I'm going to say goodbye and thank you so much. I'll get this stuff up on the website as soon as possible.